I said this at the first service. I'm going to say it right now too, because I have to say this every time. When we get into God's word, it's so important to feed your heart, your mind, and your soul with God's word. If anything that's said, you think, he said it because I'm here. That's the Holy Spirit talking. And believe me, he talks to me too. I didn't run upstairs real quick and say, oh, Brother Jose is going to be here. Let me go and put a picture up there and put it up. This takes hours. If something is spoken to you, you take it from the Lord. Okay? Say amen. Amen. And you're watching at home too. I knew you were going to be watching, so this is for you. Some people, I have to say that because some people really believe that that guy's getting into my business. If the Holy Spirit gets into our business, it's to help us and to speak to us. But I'm just a weatherman, okay? I don't make the weather. Don't shoot the weatherman. It's a fact of life that you're going to go through some storms. You're going to go through things that Jesus himself said we were going to go through. There's no place in the scripture that says you will not have problems. If you're a non-believer or if you're a Christian, you're going to go through storms. The difference is not that one goes in and the other doesn't. The difference is that one comes out victorious and the other one doesn't. You're going to go through storms. They're a fact of life. In fact, Jesus put it like this to his disciples in John 16:33. These things I have spoken unto you, he said. There's his word, that in me you might have peace. In the world you shall have tribulations, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. How interesting that most people don't use those two words in the same sentence, tribulation and good cheer. How can you be happy in the midst of tribulation? Well, he gave us his word so that we can have peace. It doesn't matter what you're going through right now. The Bible calls it a tribulation. It calls it a problem. It's called all kinds of stuff. It's called a battle. It's called a fight. And of course, it's called a storm, which I'm going to call it today. He said, be of good cheer because I have overcome the world. The one that lives in your heart has overcome the world. And that's good to know, because in the world, he said, you're going to have tribulations. People are going to hate you. Your body's going to be affected with sickness or disease. You're going to lose jobs. You're going to be rejected. You're going to go through sleepless nights. He overcame all tribulation and afflictions when he died on the cross. When he shed his blood on the cross, that was his victory against sin and against death. And when he rose from the dead, that was his victory against every work of the enemy. But he didn't just win it for himself. He said, be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. Or as one guy told me once, yeah, well, he's overcame the world, but I haven't. Well, he said, be of good cheer because I have overcome the world, because his victory is not for him. His victory is for you. If Christ lives in you, then the one who's in you is greater than the one that is in the world. And in the world, you're going to have tribulations. But he defeated the works of the enemy. Lives in your heart. Now, storms are scary. You don't know what direction they're going to take. They're unpredictable. They're destructive. And I've seen some that rip out roofs of houses, tear out trees. Some of the weirdest things you've seen after a hurricane or a storm is a straw or a pencil actually stuck into a tree trunk. Amazing stuff that can happen. And that's why the Bible calls tribulations, troubles, battles, fights, afflictions, and of course, storms. Because they're destructive and they're unpredictable. It might be a rocky marriage, a debt that you can't pay, the loss of income, the loss of a job, depression that visits you every night, a devastating accident. Last week, I was able to pray for someone whose teenage son, they invited him to church. He didn't want to go to church. I have a plan with my buddies. They went out drinking and partying. He was driving. And now, because of that devastating accident, he's 17. He's going to be in a wheelchair the rest of his life unless God intervenes. So it can be anything that comes at you. You fill in your own blanks. We're just going to call it a storm. We're going to call it an affliction, because they might be all different. But I'm going to show you with God's word today how to have peace, even when you shouldn't have peace, even when everything around you is against you, when you should be nervous, unable to sleep, depressed. I'm going to show you with God's word, and that's what Jesus said. These things I have spoken, his word, so that you might have peace in me. God's word is going to show us a window in the middle of your storm, a window that'll let you sleep, rejoice, enjoy life without anger, without anxiety, without worry, without hatred, without insomnia, and all those things that make a storm unbearable. A window of peace. Now, God didn't promise, again, that there wouldn't be storms. In fact, he said that there would be. What he does promise is peace in the middle of that storm. I want you to find the window of peace that he provides in the middle of that storm. Not human, not worldly peace, because people try to numb the storms of their life with either alcohol or drugs or partying. Some will go to a casino, just forget and leave all their money there. Now, these are not cures. They're a numbing, a temporary fix, a band-aid that doesn't heal the real problem. And that's why when the effect of the alcohol is gone, they need it again, because they realize when they come down, not only is it the same problem, but usually bigger and stronger problem. So I don't want you to look for something that temporarily eases the pain. And then it comes, that's the world's peace, not human or worldly peace. That's not what God gives. Don't try to numb with a hack, something that's temporary. God gives you his peace. Now I want you to look at Jesus' peace, because he went through storms too. His were literal. It says in Mark chapter 4, verse 37 through 39, and there arose a great storm of wind, and the waves beat into the ship, so that it was now full. The water was getting in, it was sinking. And he was in the hinder part of the ship, which is the bottom part, asleep on a pillow. Jesus, in the middle of this terrible storm, is asleep on a pillow. And they wake him, the disciples woke him up, and they said unto him, Master, King James makes it real cool, says, carest thou not that we perish? They were saying, don't you care that we're dying over here? And he arose and rebuked the wind and said to the sea, peace, be still. And the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. Now, here's the thing. The disciples were so stressed out to the point that they were accusing Jesus of not caring. In fact, if you read Matthew's account in chapter 8, verse 24 through 26, we're not reading that one. We read this one, but it gives more detail about how they were going crazy because the boat is shaking. It's falling apart. The wind is blowing. Water's inside of it. And they go and wake up Jesus. What are you doing asleep? Don't you care we're dying? You know, I wish I could say that I have never prayed like that. Lord, don't you care what I'm going through? Don't you understand how many sleepless nights? How I don't have the money that I need? How I don't have the desire anymore? Don't you care? I wish I could say I never prayed that, but I have. And maybe you guys haven't. You're real spiritual and you have lots of faith. But the disciples were so carnal, they are accusing Jesus, so stressed out with their situation and the storm, that they're saying, you don't care. It wasn't that Jesus didn't care, it's that he had peace. And have you ever heard the expression, we're in the same boat? Usually people say that when they've got problems like yours. And I've met people whose problem is always bigger, no matter what you're going through. You tell them, I haven't slept for 3 days. I haven't slept for a month. You know, well, man, they took a cut. I took a cut in pay. They cut my pay. And I said, that was nothing. My business closed down. Oh, they said that this pain is going to get worse. They told me I'm going to die. It always, you know, and there's like a competition about who's got it worse than who. But when somebody says we're in the same boat, they're saying we're in the same situation, brother. Can I tell you that Jesus asleep and the disciples were in the same boat? And yet look at two different reactions. Sometimes you can't change your environment or situation, but you can always change how you look at it and what your reaction is. He chose to sleep. They chose to be worried and really scared. I mean, we're going to die over here. You don't even care. When you have the peace of God, somebody might also accuse you of not caring. Don't you know how serious it is? You should be all messed up about it like I am. You should not be able to sleep. You should this, you should that. No, no, wait a minute. If we're in the same boat, and worrying is not going to change the storm, then I choose to be at peace. You can't change your situation sometimes, but you can change your peace about the situation. Jesus was at peace. I'm going to show you with God's word how you can be at peace even when others in the same boat or in a worse situation or not as bad as yours are messed up, are worried, are dying, are depressed, are anxious, or are hopeless. I call it the window of peace. And he gives it to you. Now, how many would like that kind of peace that Jesus had, that you can sleep through a storm? Look what it says. John chapter 14, verse 27. Jesus said, "Peace I leave with you." He didn't take that peace with him. "My peace I give unto you." Wait a minute. His peace? Yeah, the one that let him sleep in a storm that was raging when the others were all stressed out. He said, "My peace I give unto you, not as the world giveth." We talked about the peace the world gives. It's temporary. It's not long lasting. It's not permanent. It numbs, but doesn't fix. That's the peace the world gives. He said, "I don't give it like the world does. You don't have to drink something, get high, or do anything for this peace. That's the world's peace. My peace I give unto you, not as the world giveth, give I unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid." Now, I've given studies about fear. Fear is the opposite of faith. In fact, fear is as strong as faith, but opposite. In fact, fear is faith backwards. What faith grabs a hold of, fear lets go of. The mountain that faith moves, fear makes that mountain bigger, insurmountable. Jesus said, "Look, in the middle of all of that, your heart is not going to be troubled, and it's not going to be afraid, because I'm going to give you my peace." And we saw what his peace does. You're going to have his peace. And if you have his peace, that window of peace that comes in the middle of your storm, not human, but peace that God gives you, that peace is going to let you sleep and rest instead of be up all night worrying, breaking things, busting a hole through the wall, in despair, screaming out. No. That peace is going to keep you. And you know how it does keep you? By guarding the two things that the devil hits you the hardest at. Your heart and your mind. Look at Philippians 4:7. It says, "And the peace of God," that's the one he gives you, "which passes all understanding." When it says that his peace passes all understanding, you know what it's saying? That the peace God gives is not understood with a normal carnal mind. Now, the peace of the world, we can understand. People say, "Well, things go the way I like them, I'm okay, I'm at peace. But when something happens I don't like, I lose my peace." Yeah, we can understand that, right? But the peace of God passes understanding. Because when you should be all messed up and worried and have sleepless nights, you can rest in peace. Who can understand that? And here's how it does. "That peace which passes all understanding shall keep," word in Spanish, guarda, which is the same Greek word, keep, for guard, "will guard your hearts and your minds through Christ Jesus." Your heart, your emotions, your fears, your anxieties, that guard, the peace of God, stands right there at your heart, and it guards your emotions and your mind, those thoughts. Man, some people, their brain just goes a million miles per hour, thinking, "Oh, it's going to happen." The peace of God is the one that guards your heart and your mind. Now, I know what a guard is. I've shared this before. Some years ago, when a Mexican artist who was very popular all over the Latin America, Judy, got saved, I had the opportunity to minister an illustrated sermon before she and her band came out to minister. And it was in a big auditorium in East Los Angeles. And my daughter was little, and, you know, I'm back in the dressing room, and Annie had to go back to the car to get something, and the guard wouldn't let her back in. She didn't carry her little necklace that they give with a card that says backstage pass. And she got there and says to, and there was a bunch of people behind her trying to get in, and she says, "My husband's on the program tonight." The guard says, "Yeah, everybody's husband is on the program. Look at all that crowd there." She says, "No, I'm serious." And he hadn't seen the poster or anything. He didn't know me from toast. So she said, "I got to get in there. He's waiting for this." Would not let her in. And I'm waiting. Where's she at? You know, and I go over to the guard at the door. I said, "My wife's been trying to get in, I'm pretty sure. Have you seen her?" Says, there was a lady that was insisting, are you Roy? And I said, yes. Oh. And then I heard her, hon, that's me. He won't let me in. I said, would you please let her in? Yeah, I'm sorry. And he let her in. And he says, look, all I know is that she wasn't authorized to come in because she didn't have the right badge. I said, no problem. You're doing your job. And then I tripped him. No, I didn't do that. But he was doing his job. And it also happened in one of the events of Radio Nueva Vida at the Civic Auditorium in Salinas one year. There was a very ambitious guy who was a security guard. And his job was not to let anybody backstage. Of course, I had been backstage, and that's where I left my card, my backstage pass, all access. And so I'm out here meeting people, taking selfies with them and all kinds of stuff. It was a great event beforehand, too. And as I'm trying to go back in there, he wouldn't let me in. I said, but I'm the speaker tonight. Look, he says, you don't have a badge. And I said, my badge is back there. Can I go get it? No. He says, you can't go back there. And I said, excuse me, I'm going back there to get my badge. And they're waiting for me. There's a prayer meeting before. And as I started walking, he started chasing me. And I think, oh my God, this guy's going to bust my chops. He's going to get on me and he's going to knock me down. And I don't know what's going to happen here. And I finally said, Phil, get this guy off of me. And Phil comes and says, what are you doing? He says, well, he's not authorized to come back here. He's our speaker. Oh, that's what he said. I'm sorry. And he apologized to me. And I said, no problem. You're just doing your job. And I was very happy. Anyway, he was doing his job. All he knew is that you're not authorized. I can't let you through this door. And the same word that says keep is the word guard from the original Greek. So you know what the peace of God is to your heart and to your mind? It's a guard. It stands right there next to your head. And here come these negative thoughts that the enemy is sending. And the guard says, where do you think you're going? Well, I'm going to get into this Christian's brain and just mess with him. No, you're not authorized. Well, I got all kinds of thoughts to mess him up. No. Well, who are you? I am the peace of God. I am guarding this guy's mind. And he stands right there next to your heart, your emotions of anxiety, of self-esteem, low self-esteem, or depression. And he says, where are you going, negative emotions? Well, I'm going to get in that hallelujah's heart, and I'm going to mess with him. No, you're not. You're not authorized. And who are you? I am the peace of God, and I am the guard over this person's heart and mind. You cannot go in. This is the peace of God that passes all understanding, can't be understood. And you know, the world needs this kind of peace right now. You need this kind of peace. I need this kind of peace against our thoughts and our emotions. This is what I call the window in the middle of a storm. As a matter of fact, it's called the eye of the storm. And this is not changing. Let's see if we can change it to the next one. Please help me there, Andy. The eye of the storm. It's when you have a hurricane or a tornado, and you're right in the middle. When you're right in the middle of that thing, there's peace. In fact, many people think, oh, the storm is over. No, it's only halfway through. Because once it moves, you're going to get hit by the other half of the storm. But in the middle of the storm, that eye of the storm is a very peaceful area to be. And when you're in the thick of it, when they call your sickness incurable, when they say it's a cancer that's going to kill you, or when the judge says that the rule is going to be against you, and when it's at your toughest, when you can't sleep at night, you can have the peace of God that passes all understanding. It's a phenomenon just like the eye of the storm, that you are at peace. Jesus had that in the middle of his storm, and you can have that in the middle of your storm. Now, I'm going to show you the three parts that there are to a storm. First, of course, you have the beginning of a storm. You know a storm is coming because you can look at the sky. The disciples once, Jesus, the Bible says, forced them to get into a boat. And people read that, they usually, it goes right past them. Oh, yeah, he forced them. He compelled them, the King James says. NIV says he forced them to get into the boat. And that day, I know why they didn't want to get into a boat, because many of them were fishermen, and they could look at the sky and know that a storm was coming. Interesting, Jesus didn't say, okay, let's take this boat ride tomorrow when the weather's nice. No, God has called you to be a father, a husband, a worker, a servant, whatever you are, in the midst of whatever storm of life comes. You can't stop being what God has called you to be. And he forced them to get in, even though they saw that a storm was coming. You can know when things are getting bad. You can know when a storm is coming. That's the beginning. And some people, when they see that something's going to happen, they should know that is an attack of the enemy. And not necessarily because they did something wrong. First thing that comes to the head, that's why you need that peace of God to guard your mind. People say, why am I going through this? God, why did you do this to me? Listen, don't blame God for something he had nothing to do with. I remember going to a hospital once. A man was dying. His family said, he's never wanted prayer. He wants prayer now. So please go. And I went because they were members of the church. I went and it was before COVID, so you could go right in. And as I walked in, he's all tubed up, his nose, and he's got tubes and wires and monitors. And they had told him that his lung cancer had spread everywhere and he was going to die. And I remember walking in and he said, oh, Pastor Roy, I'm glad you came, in Spanish. He said, look at me. God gave me cancer. I said, God gave you cancer? He said, yeah, well, everything comes from him. He'd never been to church, never heard God's word, but he thought he knew what the message of the gospel was. Gospel is good news. Good news is not God's going to kill you. That's not good news. That's not the gospel. And I said, what do you mean he gave you cancer? Well, everything comes from God, right? I said, no. No? I said, no. What did the doctor say? What do you mean? Did the doctor say, this cancer in your lungs has come from the hand of God? No, he didn't say that. Did he say, as often as I've seen cancer this serious, has to be from God? No, he didn't say that. What did he say caused it? Tobacco. I said, what? My cigarettes. I can't hear you. Say the next. Oh. So then it wasn't God. And then he gets real religious. Well, smoking is not a sin. The Bible doesn't say it. It doesn't have to. Your pack of cigarettes, that's right there on the side. It says, you know, caution. I said, God's going to heal you. He's the healer. He's not the one that maketh thee sick. The Bible does not say, I am the Lord that maketh thee ill. He said, I'm God that heals you. When you see something at the beginning, start believing already. You have hope that it's not going to last, that things are going to get better, that that storm, you're going to make it through. Maybe you remember something else that God helped you through. But here's the thing about the middle and the end. We'll talk about that in a moment. When we see the beginning, the middle and the end of a trial, there's no place better than to see it in the book of Job. Job was greatly attacked. The Bible says that God is bragging on him to all the creatures of God, including Satan. Lucifer, where you come from? Yeah, I've come from going all over the earth. And God says, have you noticed my servant Job? How good he is, perfect in his ways. Every day he would sacrifice to the Lord for his sin and his kid's sin. Have you known? God was actually bragging on him. We have to remember that God is proud of you when you accomplish something. He's proud of you and brags on you when you do well. He's not some angry viejito in heaven with lightning. Who do I zap today? That was your grandpa, okay? That's not God. He's bragging. He said, look at him. Look how blessed he is. And here's what the devil answered. Yeah, well, of course he serves you. You won't let me mess with him. You have placed around him a hedge of protection. When we see hedge of protection, I know we think green hedges like tall grass or rose bushes. No, the hedge of protection is actually the hand of God around those that have given their life to him. God knows how to take care of his stuff. And if you belong to him, there is a hedge of protection around you. Just like the blood of the lamb that was placed on his people when they were in Egypt so that the angel of death could not go in and kill them before time. God's hedge of protection. It bugs the devil to no end that he can't penetrate that wall of protection because God knows how to take care of what's his. So he said, well, that's why he serves you, because I can't penetrate that and mess with him. And, but take that down. And in fact, the devil, these are the words the devil said to God. He said, put your hand against him and mess with him, make him lose stuff, and then you'll see how he'll curse you and deny you. Put your hand against him. Dumb devil. Takes a special kind of stupid to think that God's hand is going to mess somebody up. If God touches him, he's going to get more blessed. So he said, put your hand against him and take stuff away. God said, you go ahead and do it. It's against God's nature. If God puts his hand on him, he'll get more blessed. He'll get more favor. He'll get more protection. So he said, you do it, but don't touch him. So he did. Burned his buildings, killed his cattle, knocked down the walls of his houses. He lost children. He lost servants. Fires came and burned. He lost everything but his health. And you know what he said? God be glorified. Kept integrity. The Bible says that out of his mouth came nothing negative. And then God brags on him again. What do you think? Now, this is a story about Job. And I don't want you to think, well, it happened to Job. It's going to happen to me. Not necessarily. You're going to go through storms. But Job was different. Job was a lesson that God was teaching the devil. That there are some people, good or bad luck, things go as they like it or not, that are going to keep their faith and trust in God. And that was the lesson that God showed the devil through Job. And so he says, well, look, he still hasn't denied me. And then the devil says, yeah, because he's healthy. You won't let me touch his body. But take away his health and you'll see he'll curse you. God said, okay, take his health away, but don't touch his soul. It's one thing that the devil cannot take away from you, your salvation, the love of God, your surrender to Christ. He can't take your name out of the Lamb's book of life. He just can't do that. And so he said, don't touch his soul. So he did. He got sick. The hedge was down and he got sick. And by the way, where God is bragging on Job, that's in Job chapter 1, verse 7 through 9. The devil attacked him and sent him, like he sends people sometimes, loss, depression. But we got to stop praying dumb prayers like the disciples did. Don't you care, God? Why are you doing this to me? It's not that God doesn't care. He's offering the way out. He's not going to pull you out of the storm maybe right away. He can, and I've seen him do it. But if he doesn't pull you out immediately, he promised to be with you in the middle of it. And nothing will harm you. You have hope that things are going to get better. You begin to claim the promises of God. You remember God helped me before. He's going to help me again. That's at the beginning of a storm. At the end of a storm, I love the part where the storm's over. The problem's finished. Because the Bible says in 2 Corinthians 2:14, it says that God always causes you to triumph. Have you ever prayed for something? It happens. How do you feel after that? Whoa, the tumor's gone. The pain's no longer there. I can sleep now. I mean, you're rejoicing. And 2 Corinthians 2:14 says he always, not sometimes, but always causes you to triumph. That means you're going to come out of it with victory. Now, it won't always look the way we want it to look. So that's why I stopped giving God instructions. God, help me at work. Help me at work. Okay, here's how I want you to do it. First, kill my boss. Burn his house down. Kill his pets. Mess with him. Just destroy him and everything he owns. I ask it in Jesus' name. And do it by Thursday at 4 o'clock. You know, ask God, but how about we let him give us the triumph the way he knows. He knows all the details, knows how to do it even better. But he always will cause you to triumph. It may not look the way you want it to look. Remember, we talked about that with Joseph 2 weeks ago. He fell in that pit. How did God pull him out of the pit? Through his brothers? No. Through a prophet? No. Through an earthquake that spit him out of that pit? No. Through a bunch of gypsies on their way to Egypt to sell spices. Their thought was on money and the bottom line. God used them. I wouldn't have chosen that way, but God did. God can pull you out his way. And at the end of that victory, you're rejoicing. At the beginning, you have hope. It's going to get better. At the end, yay, it happened. But here's what I want to talk to you for a moment about the middle of the battle. When you're in the middle of it, this is what happened to Job. It says so in James chapter 5, verse 11. Behold, we count them happy, which endure. Which endure. You know what endurance is? To not fall, but stay standing. To not be moved, not be depressed, not get anxious, not get desperate, but to endure. You have heard of the patience of Job. We all hear about his suffering, but the real story of Job is about his patience. How he stuck it out. and have seen the, here's the end of the battle, the end of the Lord. See, there's a beginning to your storm. There's a middle. He looked pretty bad in the middle. And then there's an end to it, the end of the Lord. That the Lord is very pitiful and full of tender mercy. In fact, everyone knows of how his story started. He was a very wealthy man, lost everything, and how it ended. He ended up with more than he had before. But that's when God says, the end of the Lord, as it says here, is when God says, okay, the storm is over. It already worked what it was supposed to work. There's some destruction that was done by the storm, but you came out with patience. One of the things that people hate to hear about, talk about God's healing power. And yes, he heals, he works miracles. But trials, storms, work something in us. Yeah, they build our faith. No, God's word builds our faith. The Bible says the trial of faith works patience. You know what maturity is? Patience. Maturity and patience are not something that comes overnight. A little boy can put on his daddy's big boot and it doesn't fit. But someday, if he's patient, his foot will grow into it and probably out of it. Big kids got big feet nowadays. But there's two things that don't come instantly. One of them is maturity, and the other one is patience. That's why Paul said, I have learned in every situation to be contented. He said, I have learned. It didn't come to him overnight. He learned. He said, I've learned to be hungry and to be full. I've learned to be empty and to have abundance. I've learned to be in tribulation and in victory. I've learned to be sick and I've learned to be... He said, I have learned in every situation to be contented. It's a process. And God's going to make sure that you have patience. If you're an impatient person, you're going to go through some self-inflicted wounds until you learn to say, like, you're the potter, I'm the clay, mold me and shape me. You have heard of his patience. Job, the whole story of Job happened not because we think we're going to go through what he went through, but it was so we could learn about the important part of going through stuff, which is developing patience and maturing. Somebody say amen to that. Man, we didn't get too many amens. I'm going to finish this at the funeral home next door unless I get some amens. But that's the end of it. And now, the thing about him is when he was in the middle, he never complained. We're going to read that in a moment. He never said, oh man, I'm a mess, I'm sick, I'm dying. And he never murmured, never complained like the Israelites did when they went through their storm of lack of resources. They needed water. We're thirsty, Moses. We were better off in Egypt. They needed food. We're hungry. You should have left us in Egypt. Over there, we ate a lot. They complained, they murmured, they got God angry. Nothing bothers God more than what comes out of your mouth. And it's a sin that cost them their lives. Thousands died in the desert, the Bible says, because they were murmuring and complaining. Murmuring, complaining is the opposite of praise and thanksgiving. God responds to praise and thanksgiving. Not only if you complain to God, God, I'm not going to believe in you anymore unless you're dead, man. That doesn't move the heart of God. He said, oh, man, angels line up. We got to help this guy or he's not going to believe in me anymore. And he wants us to do it by Thursday at 4:00. No, that's not going to move the hand of God. It's not that moves him. Complaining is a waste of energy. It's a waste of time. By murmuring and complaining, nobody has ever done better. A boss has never said to an employee, you cussed out everybody who's a customer and told off half of the employees, so I'm going to make you manager. That just doesn't happen. And because of their complaints and murmuring, they actually missed the target of the blessing that God was about to take them into, if you remember Jericho. So when the end of the Lord comes, it's exciting. But when you're in the middle, it's very important what you do in the middle of your problem, because that determines how and when you're going to come out of it. He was under attack, and maybe you're under attack too. Job ended up with more than he had before because look what he did when he was in the middle of his storm. Let's look at the most difficult part, the middle. The middle is kind of like a middle child, very ignored, but very important. If you murmur, complain, if you give in to despair, you won't come out of it well. But when you're in the middle, Your mind and your heart are under attack, your thoughts and your emotions. That's why we need that window of God's peace that he gives you. It's there. He gave it. But like everything else that God has given, forgiveness, healing, salvation, new heart, new mind, everything he's given also has to be received. Somebody can wrap up a present for you and give it to you, but unless you receive it and open it, it never is yours, even though it's already given. God has already given healing, forgiveness, salvation, already provided by what Jesus did on Calvary, but it has to be received. We need the window of God's peace that he gives. Lord, I receive your peace. I'm not going to lose sleep over this, even though I should be nervous and upset, even though I should be depressed. I want your peace that passes all understanding, that I want to be able to rest the way you did. Now, here's one of the things that we do to get that peace. It's called resistance. You know, in order to build muscle, they say you have to build resistance. Whether it's a pulley with a weight that you, that's resistance. It builds muscle. Or weight that you lift, it pulls down, but you pull up, you're resisting. What does that do? Build muscle. And the Bible talks about resistance. In James chapter 4, verse 7, says, submit yourselves then to God. Give yourself to the Lord. Number two, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Most people won't tell you this, but according to scripture, he's a quitter. He'll flee. He'll run from you. Our problem is we quit before he does. If you hold on and resist, resisting is not rebuking. People say, yes, sometimes you got to rebuke the devil. Get out of my car. Get out of my child's house, a bedroom. Get out of my carburetor. Get out of my finances. Rebuke you in Jesus' name. Yeah, sometimes you got to rebuke. But resisting is not rebuking. Resisting simply means don't let it move you. Don't react the way the devil expects you to react. When that happens, I just lose it. This time, resist. Don't lose it. Oh, when that happens, I just cuss somebody out. They deserve it. This time, resist. Don't do it. And when you're resisting, instead of giving over to the lies and the emotions that the devil fills you with, but you grab a hold of the peace of God that passes understanding, and you resist, he's going to flee. And I'll tell you why. Because as hateful as he is, the devil's not stupid. He's not stupid. If he hits you and hits you with something and attacks you, and instead of being depressed and anxious and giving to despair, you pray more, you trust God more, you open your mouth and worship and be thankful for what you have instead of complaining and cussing and destroying your own life with words, you know what he's going to do? He's going to say, you know what? The more I bug this guy, the more he prays. The more I bother her, the more she worships. He's not going to want to get you closer to God. He will flee. He'll find another area of weakness to attack you later. You just repeat the process. But he will flee from you if you resist. I'm going to find somebody who will just give over to despair instead of this person. Man, the more I bug him, the more he seeks God. That's resisting. And when you resist, when every force comes against you, pushing you to despair, pushing you down, pushing you to mess up, to get all desperate and lose hope, you resist by not letting him move you. The Bible says it this way in James chapter 4 and verse 7 that we just read. You resist him when you decide not to respond the way he expects you to, with desperation, with anxiety, with those thoughts. You resist them and meditate on the goodness of God. Oh, it's hard when I'm going through it. Yes, it's hard because we're not used to it. It's hard to lift 200 pounds of weight. When I first went to the gym years ago, I was younger. I used to do more back then than I do now. But when I first went, I remember watching this guy who was there for the very first time. And he was looking at somebody picking up 200 pounds of barbell. And at that point, he was the dumbbell because he tried to do it. He tried to pick up 200 pounds on his first time. I'm kind of convinced that he was ruptured because he went, and the guy lifting up 200 pounds didn't start with 200 pounds. He started probably with 30 and then 50 and then built up and up until his resistance was to the point that his muscles were developed enough. And, you know, when those thoughts return, you resist them, and it's not easy to think, thank you, God, for life when I'm in pain, instead of, God, this pain is awful. But the Bible says when you do that, it keeps you in perfect peace. Look at Isaiah 26:3. Isaiah the prophet is saying, thou, God, wilt keep him in perfect peace. Who? Whose mind is stayed on thee, because he trusteth in thee. If you meditate on the Lord, keep your mind on him, instead of the person that told you off, the bully that's making your life miserable, the person who just gave you an ugly review on Facebook, the people who rejected you, or the person you love that walked out on you, that now has abandoned you, or the disease that's supposed to kill you, or the loss of your income. Yes, you can meditate on it, you can lose sleep on it, or you can think and keep your mind on the Lord. Because if your mind is stayed on him, the Bible says he's going to keep you in perfect peace. You want that peace that passes all understanding to guard your heart and your mind? Think on the Lord. Think on his goodness. I don't care what we're going through, there is something that we can thank God for. And remember, the Bible says, in all things, give thanks. It doesn't say for all things. Some people read that too. We're supposed to thank him for everything, so thank you for losing my job, Lord. Or thank you for this tumor. No, no, no. That doesn't say thank him for all things. It says thank him in all things. There's a difference. Even though Paul and Silas were in prison, they were not thanking God, thank you for putting us here. They were not thanking him for prison, but in prison, in their situation, they were singing praises to God. No matter what you're in the middle of, you can find something to be thankful for. You can find something to meditate on the Lord for. Thank you, God, for my children. Thank you for my grandchildren. Thank you, God, that I'm married to this person that you brought into my life. Lord, thank you for this job. It doesn't pay enough, but thank you that there's some that don't even have that. Lord, I may be in a situation that's stormy and shaky, but I choose to be grateful and thankful and to keep my mind stayed on you. If you do that, that peace of God that passes all understanding is going to keep your mind, because your mind is stayed on him. And this is, keep your mind on him. Read Psalms 91. Somebody said, well, do I read God's word? Yes. And then they said, I'm more freaked out than ever, Pastor. You said I should read God's word, and I did. And now I'm really scared. So, well, what did you read? I read Revelations, that in heaven there's monsters with eyes inside and outside and foreheads. And I said, would you please read Psalms? Don't read that. Let one of the pastors that understands that kind of stuff read that and explain it to you. But right now, Psalm 91, Psalm 23, things that will keep your mind stayed on. Turn on the Christian music. If you listen to the pressing country and western music, or crazy bounce music, listen, you got to balance that thing out. I'm not saying don't do it, but get your mind on the Lord. Meditate on the Lord. Neutralize some of the poison of the world around you with the peace of God. God's peace, you'll be able to rest in the middle of your storm. Other people, like the disciples that are in the same boat, will be worried, screaming, depressed, lashing out, cussing, angry, but you'll have that window of peace, perfect peace, because it's a peace that passes understanding. Here's another thing that'll help you keep that peace. Ignore the negative. Job looked so bad when he was in the middle. When he was at the end of his storm, he looked great. He wasn't sick anymore. He looked so bad that his friends, you know, when somebody's sick, friends come over to visit you, right? They bring you balloons. And because of COVID, I mean, people were sick in the hospital or home, and nobody would visit anybody. I want to see my grandkids. Okay, grandma, turn on Zoom. Zoom, what is that? You know, and they wouldn't let you go to the hospital. But when somebody's sick, friends come over, they comfort you. You're going to come out of this. Card, get well soon. Not his friends. The Bible says his friends came over and looked at him and, yeah, you look bad, brother. In fact, this is what they said in chapter 16 of Job. They said, I don't know what you did, but this is a punishment from God. And whatever you did deserves worse punishment than what you're getting. Man, with friends like that, who needs enemies, right? In fact, he called them miserable comforters. You miserable comforters. Oxymoron, no such thing as a miserable comforter. But I want you to notice what he did. He ignored their words. He didn't let it get in under his skin. He just ignored them and said, God giveth, we sang it. And God taketh away, the name of the Lord be glorified. With his mouth, he still confessed faith, even though his friends judged him. He gave no credibility to their words. And when people try to tell you, yep, what you got's bad, you're going to die. My cousin's uncle, sister's brother had the same thing and he died. So now it's your turn. Don't give him any credibility. And somebody says, this is what you're trying to do. It's never been done. You're going to fail. Don't give it any credibility. You keep your trust in God. And what God says is many times opposite of what your best friends say. In fact, it wasn't just them. Relatives might pile up against you. His wife also piled up against him. Look what it says in Job 2 and verse 9. His own wife. Then said his wife unto him, dost thou still retain thine integrity? You still believe in God? Look what she said. Curse God and die. She just, he's a mess. His friends have messed up his life by telling him, this is a punishment from God. You deserve worse. He's sick. He's lost everything. And now his wife tells him, curse God and die. God help husbands and wives to have the right words to say. I often think, why on earth would a husband or a wife want to make their spouse miserable with their words? Now, if you're a guy, you don't know. A wife might just smile, but she's counting them up, brother, by nature. And you're going to be a sad, lonely old man as she has just taken those hits inside. And, sir, maybe you're like Job. Maybe it's your wife that's the bad mouth. Just curse God and die already. No wonder the devil didn't get rid of her. He got rid of his money, his buildings, but the devil said, this one stays. Don't mess with her. Half of my work is done here. She said, just curse God and die. Look what he said. But he said unto her, thou speakest as one of those foolish women speaketh. He called her a tonta. You're talking like a dumb woman. And some husbands and some wives talk like dumb people. Not careful. I call it diarrhea of the mouth. Yeah, Jesus had a disciple who was like that, Peter. He just said stuff without thinking about it first. You think it doesn't matter? Watch this. Thou speakest as a foolish woman speaketh. What? Shall we receive good from the hand of God, and shall we not receive evil? What if good comes? Thank you, Lord. But if bad comes, what? God, you can't do this to me. In all this, look what it says. Did not Job sin with his lips? Not once did he sin with his lips. People don't realize that what you say is a sin. If you talk foolishly, he didn't. Sinning is not just drinking and smoking and cussing and stealing. And Jesus said, from the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh. He said, stop talking like that. You're a foolish woman. And he did not sin. He could have said, you're right. I curse you, God, for doing this to me. He could have said that. Oh, this is a mess. He could have cussed. He could have gotten upset. He could have done all of that. But he held his lips and he glorified God. He said, I'm going to keep in perfect peace. I'm not going to lose my peace over this. And he was attacked more than most of us by losing everything. When you're in the middle, it looks so bad. Your own family, your own friends might side with the enemy against you, pile up on top of you. But he didn't let her words discourage him. He didn't get discouraged. He rebuked her negative speaking. She wanted him to give up and die, but he didn't give up and die. And you can't give up either. You can't give up. As long as you have breath inside of you, God still has a plan and a purpose for your life. I love the way Paul said it when the storm came in his life and he was on a boat with a bunch of unbelievers, all these sailors, and they were on a cargo ship, and the ship was being torn apart in the storm. And God spoke to him through an angel, and he says to everybody, while the storm's shaking, while the boat is sinking and water's coming, he says, don't worry, we're all going to live. It sounded so opposite. They all thought they were going to die. They started throwing cargo off the boat to make it lighter. That's interesting, huh? It was a cargo ship. They had jewelry, they had furniture, they had stuff that they were going to sell. But now they're throwing it off because of the storm. Doesn't that happen when a storm comes? Our priorities change. All of a sudden, something that was so important to me now isn't important anymore. You follow that. You follow that change of priorities. They started throwing stuff overboard. And Paul said, we're not going to die because God's not finished with me yet. He was on his way to Rome where he was going to be judged. But that was the beginning of God's plan for his life, his purpose, his public calling. You say that too. When the enemy comes at you with a storm that wants to take you ahead of time, you say, I'm not going. It's not time. I'm not going to die before my time. I'm not going to despair because God isn't finished with me yet. There's still a plan and a purpose for me. There's still prophecies that are yet to be fulfilled and a dream that's yet to happen that I know is God's calling in my life. You don't have to despair. Look what the Bible tells us in Psalm 66:12. Thou hast caused men to ride over our heads. You know what that means? You're going to feel like somebody's running over you sometime. We went through fire and through water, but thou broughtest us out into a wealthy place. You're going through stuff. He's going to bring you out to blessings, to abundance, to a wealthy place. That's what he did to at the end of, we read the end of the Lord. When it was time for the storm to be over, the Bible says Job was even wealthier. He got more land and more property, more buildings, more family, more cattle. God blessed him with more. He brought him to a wealthy place. When the enemy takes you into a place of poverty, depression, anxiety, and all of these things that are part of that storm, you begin to thank God because when the end of the Lord comes, when the end of that storm comes, he's going to bring you into abundance, into a wealthy place. For everything you went through, you're going to be blessed. You'll have a new testimony. He was restored to perfect health, became more wealthy, and his story here for us is that we will be blessed too. I'll bet the devil was really upset. Man, I tried to take everything away. He ended up with more. Yeah, he steps on his own tail because of what it does to you. It bugs the devil when you resist his attempts to discourage you and you stay in faith believing that God is not finished with you, that the blessings are coming. And that's Psalm 66:12. You might have to take a picture of that one and read it in your script, in your Bible, and read the whole chapter, but that one especially. Resist the devil to make him flee. Keep your mind stayed on the Lord. Ignore the negative comments from people and relatives that the enemy uses, and be patient with them. Remember, the enemy has used all of us to say dumb stuff before. You keep trusting in the Lord. There has to be a reason. There has to be a purpose for what I'm going through. God's plan has an amazing end. It says so in Jeremiah 29:11. I know the thoughts, the same word translates plans in some versions, that I think toward you, saith the Lord. Thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you an expected end. The end of the Lord, when the battle's over. What do you expect? How do you expect that situation to end? Think it's going to end with a blessing. It's going to end with people saved. It's going to end with my body being healed. That's the expected end. And somebody today is ready for an expected end. You need to receive the peace of God, just like receiving any other gift of God. Someone right now just needs to say, God, I need your peace. When you are at peace, you're trusting him. Remember 2 weeks ago or 3 weeks ago when we talked about Joseph in his pit? What did he do to get out of his pit? Did God send an earthquake to spit him out of the pit? Did he send a prophet or did he send his own brothers? Send a band of gypsies with thinking of the bottom line, thinking of selling stuff. He used them. God can use anything he wants to pull you out of that situation. Let's let him be God and let's be at peace. I want you to stand to your feet. Those who are here, those who are watching at home, I want you to claim the peace of God. It's done. Like everything else, received by faith. So I want you to repeat this prayer with me. I want to hear you guys that are here. You at home, I can't hear you, but you can put it right there in the chat. If you're watching on YouTube or you're watching right now live on Facebook, you can put it right in there too. Repeat this prayer. Say, Father, I receive your peace. It passes all understanding. I may not understand it, but I want to be able to rest in the middle of this storm, trusting that you're in control. I give you the steering wheel. Thank you for my healing. Thank you for my help. Thank you for new strength. Thank you for your peace. Now guard my heart and guard my mind. I will resist the enemy and every thought and every emotion that wants to destroy me. I will stand in peace in Jesus' name. Now say it. I receive it as your gift to me. Amen. How many received that word? Did that minister to you? I pray it did. And we prayed a moment ago. We have an altar call at every service. We don't do it at the end all the time. We do it usually during prayer. And thank you, Jose, and thank you, Andy. And at the first service, when we do that, we minister to people. But right now, if there's anybody watching or anybody here who needs to open their heart and invite Jesus to come into your life, or you need to reconnect with God, there's a lot of people right now that have disconnected from him and need to reconnect. I'm going to ask everyone to pray this prayer out loud. Just say it with me. Say, Father, I open my heart and I invite you in. Everyone has sinned, and so have I. Forgive me, Lord. Give me a new life and that peace that passes understanding. Write my name in the book of life. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Thank you so much for being with us, and thank you at home for being with us. Those who are here, you are welcome to join us tonight at our Fresno campus. It's going to be a lot of fun. Illustrated sermon. I get to do some of the crazy ventriloquism. And we're going to have a great, great time. On your way out, give somebody a high five, a fist bump, or if you dare, a handshake. God bless you. We'll see you next time.